All right, YouTube, on today's World Poker Tour Championship Final Table, we're taking a look at the 8-Max Championship event with $540,000 for first place. Took place on Party Poker through the World Poker Tour event going on right now. We're doing Final Table breakdowns every Friday for these events. Last week, we did the Great Game of Pot Limit Omaha, and today we have the Great 2-Card Pot Limit Omaha, a.k.a. Texas Hold'em. All right, YouTube, let's get into this. We got the Nolan Hold'em hat on. You know, when we watch Nolan Hold'em, we wear the Nolan Hold'em hat. $3,200 buy-in event tonight. Make sure you like the video if you enjoy these. Subscribe more to the channel. If you have any feedback, suggestions on the layout that they're using, let me know. We gave them some feedback from last week, and they made some improvements. All right, let's take a look at our player introductions. Chip leader, Gavin Cochrane. If you watched the PLO Poker Masters event that I did commentary on Party Poker and Poker Go, you recognize Gavs. This guy is a legend of the Great Game of Pot Limit Omaha, one of the top high-stakes Pot Limit Omaha cash game players in the world, and this guy is a top poker player. He's in our chip leader. I'm excited to see what him. Me and him got some content coming up as well we're going to be doing soon, so stay tuned for that. We're going to get to learn a lot more about him. Our second in chips is Scarf Daddy, Mr. Thomas Boivin. He's from Belgium. Fifth all-time in Belgium money list. Not bad. All right, not bad. So we're going to be looking out for him. This guy seems like an aggressive player. Very excited to see what he comes up with. Third place, we got Dmitry Yurasov from Latvia. This guy looks like the kind of guy who doesn't say much at the poker table and is going to 3-bet the hell out of you, and he's not going to say anything. So Dmitry, I'm excited to see what he's got in store. He's a high-stakes regular, plays live and online. Bracelet winner as well, two in the World Series Poker, 10K 6-max. Got to be a pretty good player to take those events down. Excited to see what we got from him. Next in chips, we got Daniel Colpoys. So Daniel is from, he's playing in Mexico right now. He's from America. This guy's been playing a very long time. He got 10th place in a WCOOP event back in 2010. So he's been around for a very long time. Clearly, this guy's a regular. He's a multi-table tournament professional from America. He comes in 32 big blinds. Next up in chips, we got Mr. Sam Grafton. Shout out to Sam. Sam's been working hard lately. He had a big score earlier in this series in a side event, took home first place. He's been doing a lot of commentary on some final tables out there as well, too, on Twitch. So I'm excited to see him play. Big shout out to Sam. Really like Sam. All right, next up, we got our man Ognyan Dimov from Bulgaria. A little more harder to say. The name's getting a little bit tougher right now. He's got a 5.8 million online earnings. So this guy certainly no slouch. I'm going to be excited to see my man from Bulgaria play. Even though we know with these short stacks, they just play tight, go all in, and then they're eliminated. So next up, we got Lars Kamphues from Germany. I like this guy. His brother took down the Shooting Star event. Now he's here in the final table. Not bad at all. Next up, we got my man Jiachen Gong from Canada. This guy looks like a serious kind of guy. Doesn't have too many online earnings cash that we could find on here. He qualified through a satellite. Not bad. And last up in chips on the short stack, the battle of the five short stacks here, we got Shyngis Satubayev, and he's destined to be a poker player. He's from Kazakhstan. He's got EV in his last name. Anyone has EV in their last name, I'm watching out for. Unfortunately, he doesn't have much room to play with, but he's coming in on our short stack. All right, my BOA friends, let's get into it right now. We got the 8-Max WPT Championship final table, $500,000 for first place. Not a bad payday for a $3,200 buy-in. I mean, that's not bad at all. This is actually really good. So we already introduced the players. We got final table is 9. So they have 9 at the final table, even though it's an 8-Max, 9 at the final table. So main people we're looking out for here, Gavin Cochrane, my man down there in the bottom there from UK. He is one of the, like I said in the intro, one of the top pot limit players in the world, top cash game players in the world, top poker players in the world. We're going to be doing some content with him coming up because I want to get his story out there a little bit. The guy's been crushing it for a long time. Then we got my man Sam Grafton. Sam took down an earlier World Poker Tour side event, so he's got momentum on his side. He's been doing a lot of commentary. I just assume his game's going to be pretty sharp, and he's raising it up there with the pocket kings. So as you can see, we got the big blinds, and we got the chip stack. So I'll be going through both. Obviously, the shorter the big blind, the more you're going to be shoving all in. So you want to get more chips, right? Makes sense. That's how you win these poker tournaments. So this is 2-card Texas Hold'em. I have a Polaroid, me and Sam Grafton from the PCA right here. So we got two of them. I mean, the only Polaroid I think I've taken anytime recently. So shout out to Sam, be paying attention to how he's doing. So here we got pocket kings, raises it up. 10-9 offsuit in the big blind calls. My man Thomas Boivin, nice scarf. Anyone that wears a scarf usually is pretty insane player. Just so you know, anyone that shows up at the table with a scarf in Europe, from Europe, I mean, very rarely gonna find a tight player wearing a scarf from Europe. From Belgium, I mean, come on. Even though Belgians, I think the Belgium guys are a little maybe tighter than average in terms of the crazy Europeans or crazy I mean, seriously, these scarf wears, guys. Whatever. So, Sam. C-bets pocket kings. Beautiful board. Queen, jack, seven. Especially versus a big blind calling range. He's going to bet. Thomas has the open in a straight draw. Some of you guys might check raise. He decides just to check call. The turn, he faces a 1.2 million chip bet. So, one-third pot. He could, once again, he could raise here. Or he could call. Sham only has 13 big blinds left. So, he might think he has some fold equity. At worst, he has eight outs to make a better hand. The river comes down, it's a jack, and he misses a straight draw. And Thomas is gonna think about maybe making a bet here, so he's tanking down, thinking about leading here. It would be very unusual. I mean, this is the kind of play you see from the bad players. They like check call, and the draw misses, they bet, and you go, call. So this is something you see at like the 5 cent, 10 cent kind of tables, but I'm sure he's got a pretty good strategy for it because he leads for pot. He puts Sam all in. Sam obviously snap calls with pocket kings, and Sam Grafton doubles up. You guys let me know what you think about that play. Yeah, I mean, he's basically trying to tell Sam, hey, I got a jack, right? I check call with second pair. Interesting hand. So let's move on here. We got my man, Daniel Colpoys. So I actually found out when I was researching for the video, I had Daniel blocked on Twitter. I don't remember what happened. Maybe we told him some crazy. Don't really remember, but now he's unblocked. We were chatting a little bit. Shout out to Daniel. He's got the Mexican flag. He's representing Mexico down there, even though he's American. So he raises ace five suited here with 30 big blinds. So if you look around the table, you got Gavs is a big chip stack right now. We got my man Dmitry Yurasov. This guy looks like, listen, this guy is the kind of guy that looks like he's going to three bet you all the time at the poker table, right? And on literally on cue, he shoves all in. He's got ace queen. It makes it easy. So that hand's interesting because Daniel had 30 big blinds and Dmitry re-raised all in on top of him. And when you look around the table at these other short stacks, then, right, the other short stacks, you can't really call off there with 30 big blinds with a pay jump so big. So you can really only call there with aces, kings, ace, king, queens, it would seem. You have to fold everything else. So he does have a lot of fold equity by just shoving all in there with the ace, queen. And he takes it down. But these tournaments are so interesting. I'm really loving them. I've been studying them a lot. You can follow my study progress on my Instagram story. We almost final tabled a couple events. We final tabled one event. We almost took it down. So we're definitely improving here. We got King Jack suited folds there from Daniel. So we got my man Lars Kamphues. His brother won the WPT Shooting Star event the other day. So, I mean, this is like, these are like some sick brothers here, it appears. So Sam has ace 10 suited here. So Lars raises it up, short stack, ace king suited. Sam's gonna shove all in with ace 10 suited. This guy's got pocket 10s, my man Shyngis. He's got pocket 10s, so he's probably gonna have to fold here, right? Especially when one of these guys could bust and then he can move up to pay jumps. So let's see what Shyngis is gonna do. Shyngis is from Kazakhstan. All right, I like this guy, man. Lars obviously got an easy call. So we're gonna be all in here, ace 10 versus ace king. Sam's gonna need to get lucky here or he's gonna be our new short stack. Jack deuce five flop. He's gonna need a 10. He's gonna need a queen or a club here. Make the backdoor flush draw. River's a three and Sam, unfortunately. It's a very interesting pre-flop play, especially from early position. Yeah, it's a very interesting pre-flop play if you kind of go back and just look at that one more time. So we have 11 big blinds. We have 13 big blinds. Basically, it kind of goes back to that same concept I said last time, which is that Lars is gonna have to call pretty tight range there because he's got 17 big blinds. So Sam chooses to just jam this hand in, knowing that he can probably only call aces, ace, king, queens. So we even see Shyngis full tens. And if he doesn't have the ace, king, but raise from other position, maybe thinks he's just a little bit too light. So he decides to shove there with the ace, 10. Yeah, you can put a lot of pressure on your opponents when there's other short stacks because of the pay jumps. They're so important here. So here we go. My man Gavs. Yeah, it is challenging to see who raises it up. I'll be calling it out for you guys that are on any mobile here. So my man Gavs raises it up to 770. So he's making it a little over a min raise. Some players min raise. Some players make a 2.2 size raise. My man Dmitry, this guy is an aggressive player. He likes to play hands. This guy's not a fan of folding. So here we go. King 10 versus King Queen. Very deep stacked here. 40 big blinds. These are our two chip leaders, basically. I mean, you got a couple guys that are around 40 big blinds here. So Gavs flops the open in a straight draw. Dmitry flops top pair, second kicker. Very beautiful hand for him. Very strong hand. This is not pot limit Omaha. We are wearing the Nolan Holden hat. So top pair, a lot more valuable in this game than PLO. So they're both getting a little tricky here. Gavs decides not to continuation bet his open and straight draw. Dmitry checks back the top pair. So his hand's gonna look pretty weak here to Gavs. So if Gavs has a hand like pocket 10s, pocket 9s, maybe a jack, he's gonna probably try to get a couple straights of value from his opponent. So he's gonna bet. He bets near the pot. Dmitry checks back the flop, signifying that he has a weaker range. So Gavs bets pot. He gets called by Dmitry. And now you got to be thinking, in Gavs' spot, what does my opponent have? Of course, the flush draw gets there. Could have a flush draw. Could have a straight draw. What kind of hands is he just cold calling with preflop? Those 8-9 suiteds, 9-10 suiteds potentially. Maybe pairs as well too. 8s, 9s. King-queen, king-jack. So I'm not loving this river. Obviously, you want to make your hand. The flush draw does miss, but I don't know how many flush draws, straight draw combination hands is going to have preflop cold calling. But Gav's overbets here. So now in your Dmitry spot, this is what you're hoping for. You check back the flop. You hope to induce this type of play. Either way, it puts a lot of pressure on you. I think I'm calling here, right? My hand looks weak. When we check back, we say we got a weak hand. So when you think about hands you want to call with, King-Queen seems like a pretty good hand to want to call with here. But you got to applaud Gavs here for the pressure, putting the pressure on him. So Dmitry's in the tank. What's he going to do? He knows that Gavs is capable of showing up with a really strong hand here. Might have sixes. That'd be terrible, wouldn't it? If your opponent shows some sixes right now. That's a really big bet. 11.9 million chips. So Dmitry calls all in. But this is a really crazy play. So Gavs, the pot's 7.2 million chips. Dimitri's got 11.1 million chips. Gavs just shoves them all in. I mean, this guy's a maniac. He shoves them all in. Dmitry is calling for his tournament life. He's got four short stacks and he folds. He's left with 32 big blinds. This is a really sick hand, really crazy play. I mean, you can see why Dmitry tanks for so long before calling here. Right? I mean, I'd do this. I'd be like, what is this guy doing, man? very, very tough spot than I initially thought. I mean, the guy overbet shoves, right? But Dmitry makes the hero call, and he doubles up pretty big here. He turns into chip leader, 84 big blinds, 29.5 million chips, and that is a massive hand for Gavin Cochrane. I look forward to potentially asking about that hand. It's a crazy hand right there, guys. What do we got here? Sam Grafton, bot pocket kings, very short stack. So I've cut out some hands. I'm including the best hands, the highlight hands. I went through the 5.5-hour show multiple times to do this. I love it. I'm learning so much. These players play so tight. It's pretty crazy here, guys, how tight these guys are playing. So Sam's going to min-raise it with pocket kings. He could just shove all in, but he is going to use this as a min-raise option. And obviously, my man Shyngis, this guy's going to go with ace-queen, and he's going to be all in here versus Sam. The battle of the short stacks, and these other players are like, get these guys out of here. We want to ladder up. We want to move on. Let's get to the next pay jump. So he shoves. Sam's going to call. Sam's going to have one big blind left here, basically, to lose his pot. The flop's ace high for Shyngis, so he takes the lead 8% for our man Sam Grafton. Sam is going to need a king or a king only here, or he is going to be basically eliminated. River's a 9, and Shyngis doubles up here. That's a powerful name. Shyngis Satubayev. Satubayev. I mean, that's a fucking poker name right there. So next hand, they give Sam Grafton kings again. What's going to happen here? So Gavs has pocket fours. He's going to raise it up. So Sam, I mean, he can what? Like, he can... how many times up here at least, right? Three, maybe four, a little over four with the antes in here too. So Sam could quadruple up here with pocket kings. Dmitry Yurasov has the ace-10 offsuit. He is our chip leader. He could put a lot of pressure on Gavs right now. He does re-raise. So Gavs is probably just going to get out of the way. He knows that Dimitri's going to have a pretty strong hand here. So he does fold. And now Sam's going to be all in with pocket kings. I think he can maybe five times up here. Queen 5-6 flop. Dmitry needs an ace or a backdoor straight draw. Turns a jack, so he needs to hit a king here. He can a backdoor straight draw, eliminate my man Sam Grafton. River's a king. And Sam's eliminated. Bum, bum, bum. I was rooting for Sam, hoping Sam would Went deep here. Unfortunately, you got to win your all-ins. Kings versus ace, queen. Couldn't take it down. He's going to be eliminated in ninth place. He takes home a respectable $40,000. Not bad. I mean, it's really bad when first place is $560,000 and you take them 40K for last. I mean, these tournaments are brutal, guys. I cannot wait till I play my first big final table and I take last place, ninth. And it feels like you had a big day, but deep down inside, you're thinking about it for like the next year. Maybe some of you guys are thinking about the next. Have you guys ever done that? Have you ever made a final table and first place was massive and you took home last place and you never made another final table again? I mean, that sounds terrible. I'm sorry for even bringing that up. I'm sorry for even putting that thought into our mind to manifest that reality. That's not going to happen to any of us. All right? We're not going to do that, my friends. So Dmitry here has the Jack 9. He's got top pair. Gavs has top pair. These two have been battling here. So Dmitry check calls one street, and now Gav should bet again. He checks back the turn, though. He doesn't bet. It's interesting. So when Dmitry calls the small blind, what is he going to have? He's going to have King Jacks, some pocket pairs, flush draws as well, too. I'm surprised Gavs didn't bet there. But he does check back. River, they both make trips. So Dmitry shouldn't have many backdoor diamond hands, right? Maybe King Jack of diamonds, Queen Jack of diamonds, Jack 10 of diamonds. Gavs has the Ace of diamonds in his hand, so he faces a lead here. And now he's going to be thinking about raising or calling. In pot limit Omaha, we just call here. In tournaments, I think you can raise here because his hand, you'd have to assume that your opponent would bet a diamond draw on the turn. He would bet a jack on the turn most likely. So maybe you think your jack nine's good here. So Dmitry places a very small raise from Gavs. And now this is a really weird spot because you don't think your opponent's bluffing you here, but this is giving him a really good price. I don't think I could lay down the jack nine. It's just so unusual that you just fold. And he does fold. Very great fold from Dmitry right there. I don't think a lot of players out there make that fold. I think they would just kind of call and say, oh, maybe he could be trying to bluff me off. What are they really trying to bluff him off there, right? I mean, that's a really interesting hand. So look at this beautiful trophy. The payouts here, Sam Grafton, 40K, first place, 540,000. Second, do they get the trophy? That's what I want to know. I think the champion gets the trophy, the Mike Sexton Championship Cup. Shout out to my man Mike Sexton, who did commentary on this, with my man James Dempsey as well, too. These guys are working hard. I saw my guy GTO commentator in the mix here, Henry Kilbane. I saw my girl Lynn Gil Martin in the mix here, too. Shout out to Lynn, man. Everybody loves Lynn. Everybody loves Mike Sexton. Got some likable people on this WPT staff, I'm telling you guys right now. So Dmitry is all in these hands. He opens the 6-3 diamonds. He's our chip leader still. Thomas, my man with the scarf daddy over there, he just calls with King Jack offsuit. Doesn't 3-bet. I like that. Flops the open end straight draw. Dimitri's got a bunch of nothing. Check, check. Turn. Dmitry has an open end straight draw. So he checks back. Turns the open end straight draw. Thomas has the open end straight draw himself. Might be thinking about betting here. Seems like a very nice hand to have as a semi-bluff. But he does decide to check. Dmitry, I think we're going to see a bet from Dmitry here. Especially once our opponent checks twice. He does bet. Half pot. Certainly could be making a delay continuation bet with a hand like a 10. Certainly going to have some queens he checks back. Maybe like queen 8, queen 9 suited, something like that. So Thomas just check calls. He could check raise there, but he just check calls. I think that's pretty standard. Kind of exercise some pot control. We got a lot of short stacks. Just try to hit your hand. River, they both miss, and it goes check, check. Dmitry does not fire on the river. And Thomas is going to take down a little pot there with the king high. So you can see here our chip stacks. Dmitry, chip leader with 69 big blinds. Gavs, 54 big blinds. And we're still waiting for those short stacks to be eliminated there. We got Jiachen, Ognyan, and Shyngis down there. I mean, they're really challenging me with these real names on Party Poker. This is the kind of thing about these tournaments is that they play with real names, which I think is really cool. You get to know the players. I miss the nicknames. You know, I like it when it's like Crackhead 48 or, you know, I mean, that's nice, kind of out of line one. But there's some really interesting screen names that I really like, right? Like it's like Poker Dad 4487 or something. I mean, I don't know. I just like the screen names. They're always pretty funny to me. I always find them really amusing. I kind of miss the screen names, but I love the real names. I like knowing who the people are. But I kind of like the nickname. Maybe they should have a nickname and a real name, right? So you have Gavin Cochrane, and you can choose his nickname, like Ghost Car, or Shot Hunter, right? I don't really know. Maybe we figure something like that out. So, is the G silent? I think it might be Ognyan Dimov. Shoves all in Queen Jack Diamonds. My man from Bulgaria. He's going to be all in against Thomas's Ace Queen. Thomas has been very active this final table so far. And he flops top pair with the nut flush draw and the royal flush draw. Hits the flush on the turn. Ognyan needs to need a queen or a jack to stay alive. And he does not hit. He's going to be eliminated in eighth place. So he's eliminated in eighth place. And now we're going to see these short stacks fly. Up until this point, everyone's just playing really tight. Just kind of just waiting for people to get eliminated. It seems like what happens in these tournaments is just play ends up being tight. People get eliminated, and then action starts picking up a little bit more. But here, ace-9 suited versus 10's all in. Jiachen's going to need an ace or a backdoor spade or backdoor straight draw. Turns a queen of spades, so he needs a spade or an ace on the river. And he does not get it. Daniel is going to bust him, and he's going to be eliminated in seventh place. So we see back-to-back eliminations here in a World Poker Tour final table. So here we're going to see our payouts. We can see Ognyan takes home $48,000. Jiachen, $61,000, so not bad for them. $3,200 buy-in. A lot of people are qualifying these satellites. WPT is, they got to fill these guarantees or $3 million guarantees. We're doing all the events every Friday, and we got a bunch of really cool events coming up next week. Six Max, we got the main event. There's going to be a heads-up one. There's going to be a mini-max. We might see some a little crazier players here. We're seeing a lot of the good players in these bigger buy-in final tables. So we see a lot of great players here with experience. You know we like it when we see some amateurs in the mix. See how they mix with the professionals. Like last week on the PLO show, we saw Paresh. More of an amateur player for sure. Dmitry, a little 3-bet there. Takes it down. Putting the aggression on. He's still our chip leader, 75 big blinds. Shyngis, ace-3 of spades here on a short stack. He could shove, he can min-raise. We see players do both. I think this is more of a shoving hand. We don't really want to see a flop with ace-3. And Dmitry has ace-10 offsuit here. This seems like a hand you want to call with, but up until this point, playing pretty tight, maybe he thinks that it's going to be advantageous for him to stay in this massive chip lead because he can put a lot of pressure on his opponents and keep accumulating chips, and maybe he doesn't want to take the risk to want to bust this guy. Maybe he wants to let someone else do battle with him. So very interesting. He decides to fold there. I'm trying to think more about why he'd want to fold there. I'm just trying to come up with some reasons why, and that would make sense to me. I don't think it's standard. I think most people see ace-10 there, short stack shoves. They think that they have to call. So very interesting to note that, in my opinion. Lars here, pocket sixes. 24 big blinds. See what he does. He just min raises. Gas has the queen 8 offsuit. He's just going to defend. See a flop pair. Jack 7-7. So I think your opponent's going to be calling pretty wide out of the big blind, especially with the antes. We only min raise. Either way, two pair, sixes and sevens, very strong hand. Hard for your opponent to make trips in this game. They only have two cards instead of four. Turn is a 7. And Lars has a full house right now. Checks back to flop. Let's see what's going to happen here on the turn. Gavs just check. If you bet here, right, what are you hoping to get called by? Maybe a lower pair that didn't re-raise, some ace highs that didn't 3-bet. Not a ton of hands. Maybe a king high might call one street. So Lars is going to bet pretty small, 900,000. A little over a 1/3 pot. I mean, Gavs can put a lot of pressure on him here. And Gavs does put pressure on him. He check raises right there. Yeah, very, very interesting spot here with the pocket sixes. Lars lays it down, so Gav's aggressive play is going to take that one down. Very nice play by him. See our chip stacks right now. Dmitry still on that big stack, 80 big blinds, couple 40 big blind stacks, and Lars and Shyngis on the short stacks. All right, so during these final table live shows, my man Matt Savage is doing these, he does these like, these skits, I guess you could say, where he goes over last week's action, and he called this one the no gamble, no future hand of the week. I don't know if that's a normal thing that he does, the no gamble, no future of the week. I think I said that during commentary, because I did commentary live, and then I did a breakdown show of that PLO final table. But shout out to my man Matt Savage, man. My man's working hard, all right? Is he working hard right now? I don't know. He usually travels around for these live tournaments. He's like a master tournament director. He's like the man you go to if you ever have a tournament directing question all around the world, World Poker Tour. And now he's just at home, so maybe this is like, maybe it's not hard work. I don't know. He's like, I got to do five hands on my breakdown shows. I can do that. That's fine. Shout out to Matt Savage, man. He's been around poker world a long time, man. Long time. So Daniel pulled pocket fives, and now we got to go over this hand. I know we got to go over this hand because I posted it on my Twitter page. So he folds pocket fives, 21 big blinds on the button, lays down the pocket fives, and I got some of those hilarious responses from people, including Ike Haxton, who said, this is a good play if fifth place money is enough to clear makeup and fourth place will cover your sports debts. Basically saying that this is really, really, really tight. Yeah, so what do you guys think about that fold? Obviously, there's a 12 big blind stack and a 17 big blind stack. Daniel, if he maybe doesn't want to shove all in, doesn't want to get called by the aggressive big blind, and then bust out here with two shorter stacks still around here. Maybe the short stack, small blind, and the big blind might go to war here. Very interesting hand. Interesting decision by him. I thought about this one a lot. I talk to a lot of people about this hand. And yeah, I mean, I think this is where this kind of spot is where you could potentially really set yourself apart in terms of understanding dynamics, table dynamics, ICM, payout structures, pay jumps, and all these different things like that. So very notable hand, pocket fives, lays down on the button. I know a lot of players out there, they've never folded pocket fives in their life. Maybe in another position in some of these tournaments, but I know a lot of people out there would always raise there. I would look at that hand and say, raise, easy raise, right? Easy min raise, but with an aggressive big blind, maybe not. So here we go. Gav says pocket tens, and they award Daniel with his tight play with pocket fives with ace king offsuit. And we know what happens when this happens. When you disrespect poker by folding a strong hand like pocket fives, you get busted immediately the next hand. Is that what they say? That's what I say. I don't know. I'm always like, why didn't I just raise pocket fives? If I lose this hand, I'm just tilted at myself. He's going to be all in here. Ace king versus tens. Daniel's going to need an ace or a king. But the American's going to be eliminated here. Seventh place. Daniel, seven on the turn. River comes down. It's the five of spades. And Daniel is going to be eliminated. Unfortunately, in seventh place. Gav's going to win a nice size pot there. And he's going to chip up to about 60 big blinds. And just like that, we're going to be five-handed here, my friends. Five-handed. Dmitry, been the aggressor here, been really impressed by his play, been liking his style, liking the aggressiveness. Gavs, of course, this guy's a maniac. He loves to play a lot of hands too. He raises it up with the king seven as spades. And Shyngis, we're gonna see a little bit of him. Look at him, just kind of jumping up a few pay jumps here. He's gonna shove all in with the ace 10 of clubs. Is Gavs gonna call? I mean, it's 3.7 million more chips. We have the blinds and the antes out there. He's still going to be left with 40 big blinds. He does call, so he's going to be all in here. Shyngis, ace 10 of clubs, 62% favorite preflop. Flop comes down. Gavs has a flush draw and a king. Turn comes down a king. Shyngis is going to need a lot of help here. A jack, an ace, or a 10, and he does not hit the river. That isn't a spade. And Shyngis is going to be eliminated. But hey, he laddered up because he came in here a shorter stack. He laddered up quite nicely. He's going home in fifth place. So Shyngis is going to take up $123,000. Not bad for coming in here on the short stack. Being able to ladder up to fifth place. Could have took home 40. Now you take home $123,000. So these next pay jumps are huge. $173,000 for next place. $256,000 after that. So we are four-handed right now. One short stack with Lars. 10-8 suited, gonna raise the button here, make a min raise. 300, 600,000 big blinds. Thomas is gonna call with a 10-9 offsuit. beautiful hand and the big blind to call with. Not really, gets you in a lot of trouble. And he flops top pair. Dmitry is gonna make a bet, 2/3 pot here. He's got a backdoor straight draw. Not as many backdoor draws in 2-card pot limit Omaha versus 4-card pot limit Omaha, my friends. Not as many backdoor events at all. But yeah, these guys have been running all these satellites. They're like professional satellite hustlers on Party Poker now. They're giving away satellite tickets. They said I can give away satellite tickets. Maybe I should. Listen, if you're watching this right now, and I'll give away, I got 5 tickets. I mean, they said I can give away unlimited, but I'll just pick 5 people in the chat. So what you can get is one of these $33 satellite tickets to be able to qualify for an event. So if you want to play one of these things, let me know and say, hey, in the comments, hey, Joey, I'm one of the 5. I'll include it this far into the video. That way, whoever's watching this, like an actual person that wants to play in these events can get it. Someone, plus we reward some longevity in watching in the watch time here. So Dmitry turns the 8, and he's still ahead of 5s. He's still ahead of 4s. So he loses to 99 still, but he checks back the turn. Doesn't make another bet. River comes down. It's a king. Thomas might be thinking about going for some value here. Also could block bet too. Maybe smaller size. And he has 1.8 million. If he's got a king, he gets raised. I mean, it kind of gets called by 5s, 4s, 8s. If he gets raised, he sometimes induces, right? I mean, I don't know if he's bet folding there. Of course, you're scared your opponent did make a king. But he does just get called and takes down a nice pot there. So you can see here, Gavs is now our chip leader after that hand. He's in 6th. Him and Dmitry are still pretty close, though. So I would expect to see these two battling heads up for the title. So Thomas, he's been limping the button a lot in the action so far when I was watching this. So if you're going to limp the button, you want to include some strong hands as well, too. So Thomas decides to limp in kings here. Would not recommend trying this at home for a lot of you guys out there. I'd probably just say, hey, why don't we start raising our pocket kings? But when you start studying limping on the button, then you sometimes want to include hands like kings. It makes you tough to play against, right? You see your opponent limp with kings on the button, you're going to be thinking about that from now on. And maybe you're going to be playing a little bit differently against their limps as well, too, even though maybe you shouldn't. So Gavs here flops the flush draw, backdoor straight draw, 10 to a hearts, queen 9-7 flop. So Thomas is going to bet on the button. He bets about half pot. Gavs could call or he could check raise. He decides just to check call. He's going to need to hit a heart or a backdoor straight. Hits a 10 on the turn, which is an okay card. And it proves him to a pair. He beats some 9s. He beats some 7s. Still has that flush draw. You're not intending to fold at this point in time. Thomas is still a little bit worried about some 2 pairs. But obviously you got kings. This is kind of the problem with limping kings, is that you let your opponents come in with any 2 cards in some ways, and they make some hidden hands that you maybe don't see coming. He does bet 2.6 million chips. Gav's easy call on the turn. Got a big pot brewing here. 5 on the river doesn't change much. And now let's see if Thomas decides a value bet here. Pot's already pretty nice size. Might be thinking, what's he going to call? I mean, yeah, it's a real interesting hand here. It's the problem with the kings, right? When you limp in with the kings, sometimes you get yourself in some tricky spots on the later straights. And he does check back. And he might have wanted a little extra bet there from Gavs, but chips up a little bit. Very interesting hand right there. Very interesting hand right there. So here we go. Thomas back under the gun. Got ace-queen offsuit. 34 big blinds. We can see Lars in the short stack and 22 big blinds. So Gavs can put a lot of pressure on Thomas. And Gavs is going to 3-bet with ace-8 suited on the button. I can't really see tell where the button's at. I mean, maybe, yeah. They're experimenting with this setup. Yeah, I'd like to see more of an ability to tell who's betting. So Thomas here, is he going to fold, lay this one down? I don't think so. Ace-queen offsuit, very strong hand four-handed, especially versus an aggressive player. So he might just go all in here, maximize his full equity. Gavs, I mean, probably don't want to risk that much chips. He's still got a pretty nice nice cushion here in second place. And Gavs does fold. Thomas shoves all in. So Thomas fights fire with fire. And he's going to chip up here, and he's going to be second in chips now. So not bad here, man. Like I said, I did cut out a lot of hands because this is a long final table. We got to edit down. I'm trying to put together a nice story, nice version, picture of the final table, and then fill in the details around it as well. So we got 7-5 suited for our chip leader, Mr. Yurasov. He makes a min raise. Pocket jacks for Thomas. Beautiful hand, especially versus an aggressive player. Maybe pocket jacks aren't a beautiful hand. Maybe pocket jacks are the devil hand. He's got the devil hand. He's got pocket jacks. All right? He's got Las Vegas. He's got GTO headquarters. He's got a scary hand. So Dimitri's going to call the 3-bet, though. He's in position, could put pressure on him. And he's going to flop top pair with the 5 kicker. Thomas has an over pair with the heart in his hand, so I'd be loving this flop. I'd be liking this flop. When your opponent calls, he's going to be calling with suited hands as well, too. So if, what is he going to have, like ace-queen, maybe with one ace-queen offsuit, ace-queen suited, king-queen suited, king-10 suited. A lot of suited hands, and those suited hands make flushes here. The offsuit hands are usually going to have one high heart, if they do have one. So Thomas decides to check this hand. See what Dimitri does. Maybe he bets one straight here. Checks back the turn. Check, checks river, something like that. He can charge some, he can fold out some hands with equity here. Two over cards, for example. Get to check calls from those hands sometimes that have flush draws. Let's see, will Thomas just check call or check raise? He check calls. Turn is gonna be a jack of a diamond here. Now you're getting a little harder if you poker hard. You guys know how it is here. Now you're excited. I mean, the thing is, when you think about what hands that we are losing to on the flop, we're losing to flushes on the flop, and we're still losing to a flush on the turn. But Dimitri checks back. So now you gotta be feeling pretty good about your hand, about your pocket jacks. You'd expect this guy to continue betting a flush if he had a flush. So now you're thinking, okay, well, do I want to bet for value? If I bet and I get raised on, what am I going to do? It's a very interesting hand going on here. I mean, against a crazy guy, maybe I bet here and hope the guy raises me with him pocket jacks. And if he's got a flush, then I go cry in bed for another 10 hours. Right? I mean, no, probably not. So Thomas here, really thinking about this, guys. He does bet. So he bets for value. 10.9 million chips into 15 million, so 2/3 pot. And Dimitri, if you got the 7 here, right, what do we think our opponent has? He might have a slow play flush. He might have a slow played over pair that took a passive line. To me, it looks like he has... It looks like he has a maybe like an ace king with an ace of hearts type hand, or he's just got the nuts, which essentially has the nuts here. Especially once you check calls that flop. So that's a very interesting hand. He makes the tight fold, and these guys are battling once again payouts here. 540,000 for first place, 173,000 for fourth. That beautiful trophy. And now Dimitri's on our short stack. As you can see, he's got 28 big blinds after that hand. And now he's got ace-check offsuit. Dun, dun, dun. So our man Boivin here, Mr. Thomas, Mr. Scarf Daddy. I don't know about that nickname. We're going to have to revisit the nickname. I need to get me and Mike Sexton need to have a three-hour call where we just talk about nicknames for people, because that dude is a nickname god. Or maybe whoever was the writer of World Poker Tour is a nickname god. I don't know. But I imagine Mike Sexton's really good at coming up with nicknames. So Thomas just calls here. Very interesting. This guy is a strange player. He's a real strange guy. But he is fifth all time on Belgium's money list. Now, I don't know if that's a high number in Belgium. Shout out to my people in Belgium. He's got 2.4 million online, 2.8 million live. Is that a lot for tournaments? I mean, I don't really know. It seems like I think that probably is a lot, right? Guess it depends what events you play. I don't even necessarily know if it's indicative if you're really good or not, because I'm sure you can be really, really good, but not had a big score, right? Something to think about. So he check calls the flop. He's playing this one really tricky here. So calls pre-flop, check calls flop. And now if you're Dimitri, you gotta be pretty excited about your hand. When your opponent calls a small blind, you're putting them on what? Maybe some ace X suited, ace five suited, ace six suited, ace 10 offsuit, ace 10 suited. Maybe three bets ace 10 suited. So maybe more ace 10 offsuit type hands. Of course, you could have flush draws as well. Probably not many threes except ace three. Probably three bets ace, queen, ace, king. So you're loving your ace jack right now. And he does bet again pretty big. He gets called. And once he gets called on the turn, now you're kind of worried because the ace five makes two pair. Ace seven has two pair. But will he bet again for value? Pot's already pretty big. If he's got a flush draw, he's not. He just checked back. Very interesting hand right there. So he checks back. He gets extremely lucky because his opponent had ace queen there. And Dmitry certainly could have maybe shoved the river, you know, Could have went either way right there. But he sensed some trouble was up and he lays that one down. So Thomas is cruising right now. He's our new chip leader, man. He's just killing it. He's got king queen offsuit facing a jam from the big blind. Not a ton chips more. It's under 20 big blinds. So he might decide to call here. He's got 39% against his hand specifically. He does fold. And Lars is going to chip up just a little bit. We're going to scoot ahead here. Thomas, queen three offsuit in the small blind. He limps in. You're going to see a lot of players just limp in from the small blind with very marginal hands, like queen three offsuit, for example. So he flops top pair. Gavs has backdoor straight draw, a couple backdoor trip draws, AKA he's got nothing. I'm so ambitious with hands. Like I look at hands and I always say, oh, I always think how they can improve. How can they get better? Right? I see 7-5. I go, well, at least he's got a 7. So if the guy's got a 6 or a deuce, it's pretty good spot to be in. So he does bet, and Thomas check calls. Very sneaky player, this Thomas Boivin here. Very sneaky player, this guy. Very interesting style. I really like watching this guy play. Very interesting style. So Thomas is going to face another bet. Gavs has the open and straight draw. Thomas's hand's very underrepresented here. Does not look like he's got a queen. So don't think you're folding right here. You can't beat any other queens, but he's going to have bluffs here. He's going to turn some straight draws, turn some flush draws. And unfortunately, Gavs makes the backdoor straight. You guys know. That's why we talk about backdoors. So he makes the backdoor straight. He's obviously super excited right now. He's about... your opponent doesn't have a very strong hand here. Otherwise, you'd be a little bit more poker hard. But I think he's a solid 9 right now. On the scale of 1 to 100. 1 to 10, 1 to 20. He's probably about 9 right now. So he's going to bet pretty big. He bets near pot. And now Thomas understands. My hand looks weak. But is this guy really going to bluff me here, right? What would he be bluffing me with? Maybe like a 7-9. If he's got a pair on the flop, he's not going to bet this river. He's probably just going to show it down. So what bluffs does he have? He probably would show an 8 down. Maybe he's bluffing with a 3-4, a 4-5. I don't know. But yeah, he does lay this one down. Very nice read by Thomas. Gavs chips up just a little bit. So Gavs started off as our chip leader. And looks stronger for him because now he's got pocket kings. He's in the small blind versus the big blind. Very easy shove here for him. Maybe some people get tricky here, but I think the standard here is just shove all in. He does shove all in. Ace 8 offsuit. Nice hand for Dmitry. Can't lay that one down on a short stack. 9 big blinds to start the hand. He does call, and he's going to be at risk. I've been liking this guy play. Flopstop pair. He's going to need an 8 or an ace. Or Dmitry Yurasov. Our Latvian is going to be eliminated in 4th place. He does not improve. He is eliminated in 4th place. Shout out to Dmitry. High stakes regular. Nolan Holm specialist. WSOB bracelet winner. Enjoyed watching him play. Hope to see him again at another final table. So he's eliminated. Takes home $173,000. Not a bad payday at all. I mean, that's a real big... Man, these payouts are pretty sick, dude. $3,200 buy-in. What have I been doing playing cash games all this time? Grinding out 5, 10K months? I mean... Well, obviously in tournaments, you can lose a lot too. So, and then you sell action. You're back. You're in makeup. Sometimes you win. You don't even win anything. I can see why. Never mind. That's why I play cash games. Lars is all in. King 8 offsuit. He's going to be coin flipping against pocket five, 7-3-3 board. And Lars is going to need a king or an eight. We haven't heard much from Lars this tournament, but he's in third place. He started up as our short stack, man. But he's going to be eliminated right now. Cannot win that coin flip. But hey, not a bad showing for Lars. His brother takes down the shooting star event. Lars finishes third in this event. He qualified from a $320 satellite for this one, so not bad at all. So $320 satellite. And takes home $256,000. Okay, I mean, we don't know how much money he spent on satellites or anything like that. So now we're battling for the title here. Thomas Boivin, Mr. Active versus Gavin Cochrane, Gavs, a.k.a. I mean, this guy's a beast, man. He's been one of the top one of all players for a long time. He finished fourth in the PLO Poker Masters event we had. We did commentary on a couple weeks back on Poker Go. So he's my pick to win this event personally. But Thomas, I've really enjoyed watching him play, and he's our chip leader here. He's got 100 big blinds. Gavs has 30, so Gavs is going to have a lot of work to do. But certainly not out of the realm possibility. Nothing brewing here. Nothing brewing. 10-3. 10-4-7. 10-7-4-3 on the board. Gavs makes the 9 on the river. He's got to be liking his hand right now. Maybe go for a little small value bet. And he does. 2.7 million into 4 million. And Thomas calls. He knows his hand looks pretty weak. And unfortunately, he's going to chip up Gavs a little bit. Every small pot counts, I think, when you're heads up here. You're just trying to win any chips. Here we go. That 7-5 suited. We know that 7-5 hand was nice to Gavs earlier when he made another straight. The backdoor straight. So he calls the raise from Thomas. Oh, boy. Gavs flops the straight again. All right. Gavs has a straight and a backdoor straight flush draw. Thomas has top pair with the blocker to the 7. So this is going to be trouble. So he bets. Obviously, this is a... I think it's a better board for the big blind in Texas Hold'em. So Gavs might be over-attacking this one, especially an aggressive player. So, of course, he's going to want to have the nut straight sometimes when he does that too. So Gavs is obviously extremely poker hard right now. He check raises. And you're Thomas. You're saying, I know that my opponent's aggressive. I know that he might be making a move on this board. I've got top pair. I've got a straight draw. Maybe he's got a flush draw he could be check raising here with. So maybe Thomas wants to re-raise himself. Seems like the standard would be to call. But he does go all in. And now Gavs is like, I cannot believe what's happening right now. He calls. This is a massive pot. 62 million chips. 80 big blinds here. Jack on the turn. Thomas is drawn to a chop right now. He's going to need a... I mean, this is a brutal spot. That is a brutal spot for Thomas. He doubles up Gavin Cochrane. Gavin is now the chip leader. Not by much, but could we say that might have been a mistake from Thomas? Either way, what happens on the turn? He probably calls a bet. And maybe he doesn't lay that one down. His hand's just too strong with the 8-7 offsuit. But Gavs gets really lucky there. Doubles up. And now he's going to be in the driver's seat right now. Now it's Gavin Cochran's game to lose. Ace-King offsuit. Next hand here, he raises on the button. Jack 8 for Thomas. Flops top pair with the jack kicker. So Gavs is going to check back the ace-king. No ace, no king. Check back. You guys know how we play Hold'em around here. I hope we don't play Hold'em. I hope you guys don't play Hold'em like that. It's called a continuation bet, my friends. Learn it, love it. I wonder if anyone's watching right now that makes it this far in these videos that isn't a more seasoned player. Or at least understand what's happening. So, Gavs check checks, and now Thomas doesn't like that queen on the river. Of course, your opponent's going to have some queens. They're checking back. Queen 10, queen 5, queen 8. Name a queen. They might have it. So, let's see if Thomas goes for a little value bet here. Maybe gets called by a 4. Maybe it's called by ace high. He does go for a bet right here. Let's see what Gavs does. Gavs does have that ace high. He might be thinking that when Thomas bets this big on the river, he's saying he only has a queen or a deuce. Maybe wouldn't bet this size with an 8. Nice merge, just a little play right here. And Gavs does call. So that bet's going to get him paid off. And Thomas and Gav are going to be nearing chips right now. Very nice play by Thomas there. I like that a lot. I like that size a lot. I like it if your opponent doesn't have a queen. If your opponent's got ace high, they can call you with it. I like it a lot. So Thomas, a6 offsuit, raises it up. Gavin, 3-bets the king, queen suited. Beautiful hand. And you can see 45% preflop, but puts the pressure on him, and you can do that in this game. But Thomas is going to call the a6 offsuit. Don't try this at home, my friends. Flop comes down, king, 10-6, 3 hearts. So Gavin has top pair. Thomas has bottom pair and that nut flush draw. So he could, I mean, you can't go wrong unless you lay this one down. So Gavin's going to bet. He's going to bet a little under half pot. And now Thomas, like I said, any options in play except folding, calling, or raising. He does just call. Turn is going to be a 5. So pot's getting pretty big here, as you can see. 23.7 million chips in the pot. This is a big pot. Let's see what Gavs does here. He has over a pot-sized bet left. Thomas has 46 big blinds here. Pot's 30 big blinds. Let's see what Gavs does. He's in the tank. Is he gonna... real tricky spot. He shoves! So he puts Thomas all in. And now we said he can't fold, but... this seems like a bet size you can fold to on the turn when you don't make a flush. I mean, this is a terrible spot. Gav, it's almost like Gav knows exactly what he has. We've never seen that before, have we? Shout out to my man, Pot Ripper. Aye, Pot Ripper, that guy. So Thomas now, he's got to be sick to his stomach because he wants to play. He wants to see a river. He's got a pair, but he's got to lay that one down. So Gavin, I mean, what a great play by Gavin right there to fold out that A6. I think it's a great play. I mean, I don't know. What do you guys think? That's a questionable play. So Thomas raises it up here. Queen 8 offsuit. A lot of interesting hands this final table. I really got to watch this back a few more times and go over this with a couple friends because some very interesting hands I'm taking a look at. So Gavs check calls the ace high. Turns the ace. But no. When you're running well, you're running well. So Thomas... of course, your opponent's going to be check calling ace high. He's going to be having 7s, 4s, straight draws, queens. So Thomas does check back. River comes a 3. The 5-6 gets there if your opponent had 5-6. 3-4 gets there. 7-4, 7-3. 7-4 was already there in the house. Gavs is obviously going to bet. No, he checks. Okay. So now his hand is disguised. So we've seen Thomas go for value with these second pair type hands. I expect to see him do it again. 5.3 million chip pot. He does go 3.2 million chips and Gav's obviously going to be loving this. Assuming he's going to call. But he decides to raise. So, wow. So Gavin has the top pair, weak kicker. He check raises the river and Thomas sniffs that one out, lays it down. Nice play by Gavin and he is putting the pressure on him. Our blinds went up 500,000 to 1 million chips. So that means when the blinds go up, the stacks get shorter effectively. Otherwise the tournament might go on forever. So still anyone's game. They still got a lot of room to play right here. Thomas raises it up, jack 9 offsuit. Gavs is going to call. You can see players heads up play a lot of hands. They play a lot more hands in the button, a lot more hands in the big blind, especially that min raise. So you got to get comfortable playing these wider ranges because this is where you win all your money. Look at the pay jumps, guys. They're massive. You got to get better at playing your heads up game if you want to be able to make money in these tournaments. And that means you got to play the 8-2 suited, right? You don't play the 8-2 suited much in full ring. So it's a total different adjustment when you get to heads up. You really got to have your game locked in sharp because, I mean, yeah, it just seems incredibly important. So we get to the river. Gav says his 8. He checks. Thomas, jack high. Call me with a jack high. What's he going to do? Is he going to bluff? I don't think it's going to work. He's tanking down. He does bet. Bet's pretty big. 7 million chips. Gavs calls quickly, and he is going to win a pretty big pot there with the 8-deuce suited. Like I said, you got to learn to play your 8-deuce suited. So Gavin right there, he is going to be a pretty big chip leader. He's 4-1 in chips right now. 82 big blinds to 22. So Thomas just limps in with the 6-9 suited. Gavs punishes him, raises it up to $4 million. $4 million. I like when they used to watch tournaments and they would call this dollars. They go, he has $19 million in front of him. Maybe we should just say that. Fuck it, let's go with that. Gavs raises to $4 million. Bets $1.9 million. I just can't say it. It's chips. It's not real dollars, right? It's not necessarily the equivalent. Maybe it gets people excited. I don't know. So Gavs bets a little, very small bet. Takes it down. Love watching Gavin Cochrane play, man. I feel like I've watched this guy play more than almost anybody with the PLO. He was always at the final tables of the PLO Poker Master Series, so we got to see him watch him. Got to see him play a lot. Shout out to my man Jeff Platt. Did commentary on that with him on Poker Go. Thomas shoves in there. Nothing happening. 7-2 offsuit. Beautiful hand. Is it? Not really. He folds the button. Not many hands you're going to fold the button if you're Thomas, but 7-2 offsuit's one of them. Pocket fours in the big blind. Gavin limps in. See if Thomas shoves all in here or just checks or raises small. He does shove all in. And Gavin folds. Still anyone's game. Can Thomas Boivin come back? Can our Belgium come back? Can Scarf Daddy come back? Scarf Daddy. I don't hate it. You know, I don't love it. I don't hate it, though. Okay? It's better than nothing, right? I mean, look at that fucking scarf he's wearing, guys. It's a great scarf. It's like a snakeskin scarf. So he raises out pocket nines, or he limps with pocket nines, rather. So what you want to do is you want to protect your range here. So if your opponent's just going to be raising a lot of your limps, then you want to include some strong hands. So he includes pocket nines. That way, if he gets raised by Gavs to $4 million again, he can just shove all in. So he wants to protect his range. 10-4 offsuit. Gavs limps in. Thomas raises. A lot of raising and praying in this game. You say you make a raise and you say your prayers. You say, run the five cards. Let's see what happens. Uh-oh, this could be it. Ace-Jack offsuit versus Ace-4 offsuit. Thomas limps in. Gavs is going to make a big raise. Let's see if Thomas goes for that limp raise, as we just talked about. Not going to go well for him this time. Thomas is in the tank. He does raise. He goes all in. Limp re-raise. Gavin calls. This is going to be our title. 10-8-7 board. Not good for Thomas. 13% to win here. He's going to need a 4. Or he can now chop with a 7 or an 8. He's going to need a 4, a 7, or an 8 to stay alive in this tournament. River's a jack, and he is going to be eliminated in second place. Gavin Cochrane, coming into this final table as a chip leader, is going to win the World Poker Tour 8 Max Championship online event. Very wonderful play by him. Very much enjoyed seeing our man Thomas play. Hope to see him play again at some point in time at the final table. Gavin Cochrane is our World Poker Tour champion. He also final tabled event 1 in the PLO8. This guy, clearly a player who knows how to play each type of game. He is going to take home $500,000 for his showing. As you can see here, $540,000 for Gavin Cochrane. Thomas takes home $388,000. Seems like hours ago, Sam Grafton was in a high place to come 40K. But yeah, man, that was a great show. Really enjoyed what I saw. Really enjoyed the play. Enjoyed the spots. I learned a lot. My big takeaways from here, from what I saw, are that they play very, very tight when there's 9-handed, 8-handed, 7-handed, 6-handed. A lot of folding. Chip leader puts a lot of pressure on your opponents. You really got to be aware of who's aggressive, who's really tight, who's maybe overfolding, who you could take some advantage of. And then you got to learn how to play those wide ranges once you get shorthanded. And then you got to win your all-ins. You got to win your all-ins. And you got to think about limping strategies too. A lot to think about, a lot to hit the lab with here. Hope you guys enjoyed. Like I said, every Friday we'll be back. And we got some other events coming up too. So I don't know how many events we're going to be able to get on with the whole cards up, but we're going to be doing a lot of these events. So tune in more if you want to play the events coming up this weekend. Join Party Poker. The events start on every Saturday. And tomorrow's Six Max, so I'll be paying attention to that. My man Pav's going to be playing that stream, and that I'll be paying attention to Pav. I'm sure Jamie Staples, Jeff Gross, Mr. Drummond are going to be in those events too. So check those guys out on Twitch if you want to see those live streams. That's it. Much love, guys. Peace out. Like the video if you enjoyed it. Subscribe for more. That's what I got, man. Man, I love watching these hold'em. It's kind of fun. See you guys later. Peace out. Take care.